worship. I am glad that you're here and have a number of announcements to share with you this morning. First, I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you to the Penningtons for hosting us last Sunday for a cookout out at their place. And it was a bit chilly, but not too chilly. And we were a small group, but not too small a group. And the food was wonderful. So thank you, thank you, thank you to all who took part and helped to make that a good event. The timing, I think, was just perfect. They had a fire pit going, so we could all just stay outside, eat outside. And by the time we had all had a chance to eat, the rain started sprinkling on us.
Yeah.
And so that sort of ended it, and it was time to go
over here.
So it worked well. Today is a dedication of pledges that we are going to do when the offering is brought forward. So we have extra copies. If you filled one out and you left it sitting on your dining room table and you forgot to bring it with you this morning, all you have to do is raise your hand. If you never got one in the mail and you would like to fill out a pledge card, all you have to do is raise your hand. If you just completely forgot that that's what we were doing this morning, raise your hand. And we've got extra pledge cards that we can share with you. We have, yes, okay, so raise your hand. And okay. Deb, 1, 2, 3, 4. See, I knew that that would happen. And that's why we... That's why we planned for you.
Actually, you're just going to stand here and hold your hand up the whole entire
service. She's coming. She's coming. She's coming.
I got you,
Devin. We
got it.
We just need to turn it in. Okay.
Is that it?
That's it.
Okay. And a reminder to all of you, this coming Saturday evening, you need to turn your clocks back because it's the end of daylight savings time. And, that way you'll get to worship on time next week. There is a liturgy sign-up sheet at the back in the vestibule, and we are going to start back having liturgies beginning next Sunday. If you are willing to be liturgist with me, I would appreciate it, and just take one of the Sundays signed up at the back, and I can be in touch with you. Those of you that have been joining us for worship online, I just want to give you a heads up that next Sunday is a communion Sunday for us. But there is a way that you can participate in worship with us. If you just gather some bread and some juice, you will be at the ready. And when we take communion, you can share in communion at home. Next Sunday is All Saints Sunday, and the tradition that I am used to and that I want to bring here, if you haven't been doing it, is that we will toll the bell for all church members who have died since November the 2nd of last year. So Dana's going to have a bell, and we will toll the bell as we call out the names. Loretta has already given me the list of those names that we printed in the bulletin. After we toll the bell for all of those who have died in the last year, you will have an opportunity to stand and name other names, maybe someone in your family, maybe your best friend from high school, whoever else you might want to name, and us toll the bell for them. You'll have an opportunity to do that next week. Prayer concerns that I have. Oh, just a reminder, we've started singing, still having masks on. If you're not comfortable singing, sit behind the pews where the balloons are back there. If you're ready to sing and you want to sing, then sit in front of the balloons, more towards the front of the sanctuary. pastoral concerns now to share with you. Dave Nitzel, I think I'm saying that name correctly, had surgery October the 20th, but Barb Nitzel is having surgery tomorrow morning. So hold both of them in your prayers. Dave, as he is healing, and Barb, as she prepares for surgery tomorrow. I think that's all of the announcements that I have for us this morning. So we are ready for the Christ light to be brought in. Please join me in the call to worship. We are challenged to learn about God each day. We are summoned to let the Spirit move and work within us.
May God open our minds and widen our hearts so we might grow in love.
More than we are prepared to give, that you will lead us where we not want to go. We stand on the edge of your promises and hopes, yet cannot seem to let ourselves cross over into the life that you intend for us. We sing and talk about your love without allowing you to transform our lives by it. Forgive us and renew our lives by your grace. Amen. In our baptism, we are clean and united with Christ. As we confess our sins through Christ, we are accepted and made whole. Believe the good news of the gospel this morning. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. Assures us that we matter to you. So use us in ways that we are not aware of, to touch the lives of others, to speak a kind word, to offer a loving touch. Give us faith to trust our lives to you. Open our minds and hearts this morning as together we listen for your word to us today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our reading this morning is Deuteronomy 34, verses 1 through 12. For several weeks now, you've been walking through with me hearing the story of God's people in Deuteronomy. This morning, we hear about the death and burial of Moses as the book of Deuteronomy draws to a close. Moses is revered by the people as a prophet, unlike any other, as someone whom God knew face to face. So listen for God's word this morning. Then Moses went up the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, which is opposite Jericho, and the Lord showed him the whole land. Gilead, as far as Dan, all Naphtali, and the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah, as far as the western sea, the Negev, and the plain, that is the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees, as far as the Zor. The Lord said to him, "This is the land of which I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not cross over there." Then Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab at the Lord's command. He was buried in a valley in the land of Moab, opposite Beth Peor. But no one knows his burial place to this day. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His sight was unimpaired and his vigor had not abated. wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days. Then the period of mourning for Moses was ended. Joshua, son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him, and the Israelites obeyed him, doing as the Lord had commanded Moses. Never since has there arisen a prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. He was unequaled for all the signs and wonders that the Lord sent him to perform in the land of Egypt against Pharaoh and all his servants and his entire land, and for all the mighty deeds and all the terrifying displays of power that Moses performed in the sight of all Israel. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. This is the word of the Lord, the word of life.
Thanks be to God.
So this morning we come to the end of Moses' story. It's a long one in the Bible. The story of Joseph and the story of Moses, longest ongoing stories recorded there. Now, I don't know about you, but it leaves me a bit unsettled, uncertain. I've had a lot of questions. I mean, here is Moses. The Bible says that there has never been anyone else who had such a close and special relationship with God. Protected by God at his birth, he was chosen by God as a man for an amazing task. He was led by God throughout his career, and he was buried by God at his death. Moses! All caps, bold letters, Moses. For the last 40 years, Moses has been on a grand adventure, making his way to the promised land. And now, as he stands on top of Mount Nebo, on the very edge of this land of promise, we hear that Moses doesn't get to finish what he started. This is the land that I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not cross over. Moses, God's faithful instrument of deliverance, dies without ever setting foot in the promised land. Here is unfinished business, it seems to me, and so my sermon title, Unfinished Business. I want to say, but this isn't fair. Moses has been faithful, enduring decades of frustration and disappointment. I really like how one preacher describes his disappointment at the ending of the Moses story. He says, for this he had struggled to lead a people often as stiff-necked as the bondage they escaped and as unruly as the wilderness they tramped aimlessly about on. For this he had given up herding sheep to herd slaves. No doubt, in some respect, the sheep proved easier, and in almost every respect, they proved better company. Small wonder that Yahweh had heard the Hebrews complaining in captivity. They were good at it. Indeed, Moses' own ears had been ringing with their incessant whining ever since, like some group of disgruntled tourists, when they weren't griping about the accommodations. They were bellyaching about the food or lack thereof. They were constantly murmuring that things would have been a whole lot simpler if they just stayed back in Egypt. And I dare say Moses himself would have eagerly seconded that motion if he weren't already preoccupied with trying to persuade the Lord not to wipe them out altogether. All this he put up with. And in the end, Moses only gets a glimpse of his life's goal. It doesn't seem fair. You haven't had a chance yet to get to know me real well. I realize that. But if you knew me, you would know that I am not a big sports fan.
No.
I understand baseball well enough because I dated a baseball player in high school. And you know, when you're wanting to impress somebody, you kind of learn what they love. But baseball is usually too slow to keep my attention. Now, I know that there are probably some of you sitting out there who would argue that point with me, but there you have it. I think baseball is pretty slow. I'm clueless about football because you never know where the ball is, and that frustrates me. But when my oldest son played football in high school, and I was complaining about that fact, and he said, "But Mom, that's the whole point. You don't want anyone to know where the ball is." And I was like, "Well, then it's no fun to watch." So, last week, when I was trying to find something to watch on TV, I was dissatisfied with my options. There was football and baseball. I think I even clicked past some wrestling and soccer as well. In the end, I just turned the television off and went and read a book instead. No surprise there because I love to read. I know it's blasphemous for some of you that there are all these options for sports, finally, and I don't care a lick. At any rate, all the sports options got me to thinking about Moses. Can you believe that? Like, really? You know, for a preacher, the topic of the sermon is never very far from our minds. Just know that it surprises me to no end that sports have become a metaphor woven into my sermon today. Maybe it's because last week our son, Michael, was interested in how the Braves were doing in the playoffs. Now, remember, I'm a Southern girl, and when you marry into the Montgomery family, you marry into the Atlanta Braves. Okay? I know how to do hook 'em horns. No, that's Texas. See how little I know? Michael wanted to know how the Braves were doing, and he was traveling. He has to travel one day a week with his work, and so he was driving, and he couldn't, you know, check it, and he couldn't find it on the radio, and he called me. He really called his dad, but his dad was on a Zoom meeting, and so his dad couldn't talk, so I'm the last choice. He called Mom. He wanted me to turn it on, find a game, and give him an update, so I did. But while I was there on the game, they were talking about the pitcher. So the first pitcher, he'd been pitching and pitching and pitching. I don't even know who he was pitching for. I can't remember his name. None of that matters to me. He had long, curly hair. That's what I remember about him. And it was talking about how many pitches he had pitched, like 117. And I was thinking, wow, that, you know, that's a lot of pitching. And again, while I was sitting there talking to Michael on the phone, they switched pitchers, okay? I don't know. I thought this week working on the storm and that ballgame was sort of like Moses. Moses is going to be replaced by Joshua. And I wondered whether that first pitcher, was he thankful that someone else was going to step up and relieve him and finish the game for him? Or was he disappointed that he wouldn't be finishing what he had started? I had all these questions. couldn't swear to it, but I think I saw different colored uniforms on the football fields. And I got to thinking again about this sermon that I read this week that said, life is seldom like a track meet. Can you believe all these sports meets coming out of my neck? You seldom in life run in a straight, predictable direction until you finish the race. Like, life doesn't usually work that way. And that got me thinking that I remember seeing those football players zigzagging down the field, trying to avoid getting knocked down, and that maybe life is more like a football game. There are obstacles that we have to deal with. You have to change direction sometimes. You have to bend and swerve, and when you get knocked down, you have to get back up. And sometimes one person gets to carry the ball all the way for a touchdown. But more often than not, the ball changes hands several times. That's why I never know where it is. And lots of times the football player who is carrying the ball is stopped just short of the goal. Do you see where I'm going with this? Moses! Isn't that Moses? Perhaps the art of living is not so much our ability to pick one path and pursue it doggedly to the end. It has more to do maybe with how well we are able to change paths and shift directions when the situation demands it. Most of all, the art of living is the ability to respond with grace and faith when the journeys we make in life are interrupted or left unfinished. I guess I could have us shrug our theological shoulders this morning and conclude that this is life. Disappointment after disappointment, and that we, like Moses, have to learn to deal with it. And to a point, that's a true statement about life. But I can't help but believe that there is something more important to this story at the end of Deuteronomy. Something deeper and more significant that we have to learn in order to deal with life's disappointments. So let's wrestle with this story a bit. I said that it doesn't seem fair. Why is it that Moses is denied what he has spent his whole life trying to achieve? I mean, he's been trusting, he's been obedient, he's done what God told him to do, he has been faithful. So why? And then it hit me, that is often our question, isn't it? As we seek to make sense of our lives, why, God? Why this, not that? Why now, not then? The simplest explanation is that Moses breathed his last on the mountaintop because he was an old man. Paul Schurer once suggested something along those lines, wondering whether this grand gray prophet just climbed the mountain, hiked to catch a glimpse of glory that was Canaan, and he died there, worn out by the years, winded by the steep ascent. Maybe it's as simple as that. And I think that there is some truth here for our own lives. Time for us mortals is not limitless time. Moses tries to silence the people's complaints once again. This time they're whining about water, and God tells Moses to take the staff with him, but only speak to the rock instead, as if in a flare of the dramatic, he lifts his hand, and he strikes the rock twice. Water quickly flows out, but in the end, God is angry with Moses, because he didn't do what God told him to do. And then in Numbers 20:12, it says, because you did not trust in me to show my holiness before the eyes of the Israelites, therefore you shall not bring this assembly into the land that I have given to them. If this was some divine test, obviously Moses had failed it. But I'm left wondering what that says about the God of mercy and grace, the God who invites us to trust our lives to God's steadfast and unfailing love. Moses is faithful to the tasks that God set him to do. Moses pours out his life for a stiff-necked people and over again implores God to show them patience and mercy. We can read about the ending of Moses' life and acknowledge that sometimes our lives do not turn out the way we imagined they would. But again, I think that there is something more to the story than that. Perhaps rather than looking at the story from Moses' perspective, we should look at the story from God's perspective. The narrator tells us why Moses dies just short of the promised land. And it isn't because of bad luck or cruel fate. It says nothing here about disobedience or disappointing God. In this passage, in verse 5, it says that his death isn't in accordance with the Lord's command. Perhaps the question we need to ask, perhaps the deeper meaning in this passage is not about Moses, but about the unfinished business of Yahweh. From the beginning, God's desire has been to establish a people of faith. Could it be that in order for the people to take the next steps towards faith, they have to proceed without Moses? It would do little good if the one who has tried to teach Israel to rely upon the Lord were in fact to deny them the opportunity because of his continued presence with them. Ultimately, I suppose that's the point of unfinished business. To make us realize how dependent we really are upon the Lord. I mean, if we could achieve all that we set out to accomplish, if we could realize every aspiration and obtain every goal, what need would there be of a sustainer, or for that matter, a redeemer? Reinhold Niebuhr once said, nothing worth doing can be accomplished in one lifetime. From the story of Moses, I am reminded that our story is a part of God's greater story. Here is the deeper meaning of this passage, I think. It is precisely because God's story lives on that our stories become significant, even when partial or unfulfilled. As Moses stands on the edge of the promised land, he doesn't talk about his own disappointment. Instead, he talks to the people about God. He tells Israel, be strong and of good courage, for you shall go into this land. It is the Lord who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not fail you or forsake you. Do not fear or be dismayed. God of Abraham and Sarah chose a covenant people to bless all the families of the earth. Hearing their cry, God delivered the children of Israel from the house of bondage. Loving us still, God makes us heirs with Christ of the new covenant. Our confidence and hope for ourselves and other people does not rest in the powers and achievements of this world, but in the coming and hidden presence of God's kingdom. With believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. We are going to bring not only the offerings up this morning, but all of the pledge cards that have been brought in. May your love be in our hearts, your grace in our words, your compassion in our hands, and your peace fill our lives as we seek to put our faith into action. This morning we bring not only our gifts and our pledges, but we bring the food that we have been collecting week by week. Again, an expression of gifts given and returned to you. Bless them, Lord, even as you have blessed us. In Christ we pray. Amen. Praise the people. I should just weave all that together, but I never think of it. Okay. We're going to pray again, and it's never bad to pray too much. I don't think you can pray too much, actually. Let's pray. Creator God, we give you thanks and praise for this new day. We give you thanks that you have made us in your image, that we can know you and love you, trust you and serve you. There is much that touches our lives that we take for granted. For the biblical story and the good news passed down from age to age through your disciples. For the church whose doors continue to open out into the world. We pray this day for strength and healing for any who are sick among us. We pray for comfort and peace for any who are grieving. And Lord, we pray for ourselves, that your spirit might awaken us to the call of discipleship, that we might renew our commitment to Christ. You promised the descendants of Abraham and Sarah the blessings that come by trusting your will. As we continue our journey in quest of your promised land, send your spirit to accompany us. We carry with us burdens of past failures and present uncertainties, so reassure us of your acceptance and forgiveness in Christ, so that we might be free to live life joyfully and fully. Hear us now, Lord, as with one voice we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. 2. Like Moses, we are living our lives seeking to be faithful to God. And if nothing else you take home from today's sermon, know that as you live your story and trust your lives to God, that God is writing his story through you. Go out into the world as God's people. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.